it's very interesting to see the MGM lion roaring in front of the American International logo, because at the time I did The House of Usher, or in the original title of the short story, The Fall of the House of Usher, American International was the up-and-coming smallest distribution company, and MGM was, of course, the greatest of the majors. This is Roger Corman, and we are seeing Edgar Allan Poe's House of Usher, or as I say, The Fall of the House of Usher, starring Vincent Price, Mark Damon, and Myrna Fahey. Now, the very first shot and the next couple of shots are as the result of a forest fire in the Hollywood Hills. I was working on a number of Freudian theories when I made the Poe pictures. I may or may not still believe those theories, but one of them was that we should not see reality. These stories were the stories of the unconscious mind, and I needed the shots of Mark Damon, riding forward to see the house, which is, of course, a match shot. And then we cut back to Mark in the burned-out area. I'd read about the forest fire in the Hollywood Hills in an article in the Los Angeles Times, and there was a picture of it. And I called quickly and put together a crew, and we went out there and got, I've forgotten, three or four shots in an area with as little vegetation as possible. We tried to let a little ground fog come through, and then when we cut to the match shot of the house, we had again a little ground fog, and then we had ground fog and spider webs and everything we could think of when we came to the actual set. Probably there should have been a creak when that door opened, but these pictures were really shot on a very low budget and fast schedule.
Is it serious?
We shot in 15 days, which for me was the longest schedule I'd ever had in my life. I'd never shot a picture in more than 2 weeks before, and our post-production budget, as well as the entire budget, was fairly low. These pictures were all made for a little bit less than $300,000. And there are occasionally one or two things missing, such as the door squeak. But in general, I think we got all we could out of the schedule and the budget. I might mention that Mark Damon, a very handsome young man there, eventually became a star in Italian westerns, learned Italian, and became an American-Italian distributor of foreign films, and now is a major international distributor.
Taking them off.
Taking them off? What on earth for?
This was the first film I had shot in scope. I don't remember whether it was CinemaScope or one of the less expensive anamorphic lenses that were designed after CinemaScope. I'm not certain they really should have been shot in CinemaScope, because CinemaScope is really best for, say, a Western or some exterior vista to show the immensity of the horizon. And when shooting inside a house, you're not exactly working with what a CinemaScope can give you. But American International wanted the name CinemaScope on it, and I used it as best I could. For instance, here, as Mark moves around the room, I use CinemaScope with a wide-angle lens in order to give a feeling of greater depth and greater size to what was essentially not really that big a set. And shots is when Harry Ellerby, the butler, appeared behind Mark. He comes in fast and abruptly, just to give a little bit of, not a shock, but just a little sense of something there rather than a traditional entrance. I've always felt that something appearing quickly from the side of the screen gives it a little bit of accent. There are, of course, very few people in the House of Usher, and there is Vincent. And that was a deliberately set up shot utilizing what I had said earlier, the fast entrance, this time coming straight into a close-up as the door opens.
I felt I had the right. Well, we can't talk out here.
Vincent was very, very good. I felt he was my first choice for the role, and I thought he was wonderful. He dyed his hair to give him that gray, somewhat distinguished look. I thought he was really excellent in the role, and he won a number of awards at European film festivals, as did I, but Vincent won more awards than I did for the picture.
My apologies.
We worked very hard on the sets and the set dressings. I was a believer, and still am, in what we used to call in art history 1A, articulation of the surface, which is to fill the surface of the set with objects, with paintings, with statues, even the chairs, having ornate carvings. All of these things were rented from a prop house, and it doesn't really cost that much more to rent more ornately carved objects than the straight objects, and we filled the sets with as much as we could. Here is Myrna Fahey, a very beautiful young girl who was a very fine actress and went on to have a substantial career of her own.
Yes, to see you.
Madeline, I must insist.
We shall talk later, Philip.
Mr. Winthrop is leaving.
This was Myrna's first leading role. It led to her getting a contract at Universal, where she starred in a number of big-budget films.
Very well, he will stay. Now, for pity's sake, return to your bed.
She then went on to play the Elizabeth Taylor role in the television series, Father of the Bride. I didn't see much of the series, but I always wondered, how do you go on week after week with Father of the Bride, with the whole thing just leading up to the wedding? I guess you follow the newlyweds. I used a lot of moving camera. Oh, and there is a picture by Bert Schoenberg, a very strange young painter who is having something of a vogue in, post-beatnik, pre-hippie coffee houses and art galleries in Hollywood. I commissioned all of these paintings, and everybody at the end took one as a memento. I still have mine.
Mr. Winthrop, are you actually planning to marry my sister?
Mr. Usher.
I took the portrait of Vincent Price for myself. Vincent chose one of his ancestors, as I recall, which surprised me. But I think that was very nice of him, because he knew I wanted his. And it probably would have been a little bit, I wouldn't use the word egotistical, but self-satisfied to pick your own picture. Frankly, I would have picked my own picture.
And I suppose this vision includes children?
God willing.
God willing. If you knew the nightmare you were picturing for me, sir.
Nightmare?
That's what I said.
I've always tried to shoot in depth, and particularly when you're shooting interiors, it presents a problem. I try to have some sort of foreground composition, and then something in the distance. And, for instance, in this shot, we have Mark Damon in an over-the-shoulder shot as the foreground composition, then featuring Vincent, and behind him is a statue. So we have three levels to give the illusion of depth. And as we reverse to Mark, we do the same thing.
But under the circumstances, it is quite impossible.
But why do you assume that you are dying?
There are many reasons.
Pray give me one, then.
As I was saying, I used a lot of moving camera because there's so much dialogue in the picture that if I didn't break it up with a lot of close-ups, a lot of inner cuts, a lot of moving camera, we could get a static quality to the film.
The longer, but both of us are afflicted with it. Any sort of food more exotic than the most pallid mash is unendurable to my taste buds. Any sort of garment other than the softest is agony to my flesh. My eyes are tormented by all but the faintest illumination. Odors assail me constantly.
I had what many people considered to be the best independent crew in Hollywood. They were sometimes called the Corman crew. And when they weren't working with me, unlike other cameramen, art directors, grips, gaffers, and so forth, who would just get their next job, people would hire them as a unit when they weren't working with me. So they developed an esprit de corps and also a way of working together so that everybody understood everybody else's job. They were very efficient and very good.
Three quarters of my family have fallen into madness, and in their madness have acquired...
The key, of course, was Floyd Crosby, who was my cameraman, I would say, on at least 20 or 30 films. Danny Haller was the art director who did all of the Poe films and went on to become a director in his own right. Jack Boyer was my production manager, Chuck Hannawalt, the key grip. And they all worked together, and we were all friends.
Peculiarities of temperament.
One of the things that enabled us, I think, to shoot so rapidly, to shoot a picture of this complexity in 15 days, was at the end of shooting every day, Jack Boyer, Dan Haller, and I would leave the set, go over to the Nicodel, which was now defunct Hollywood restaurant two blocks away, and have drinks and dinner charged to American International, and then go back to the set and spend an hour or so going over, working out all the shots for the next day and readjusting units. Sometimes we would take objects from one set and move them to another, putting them in different positions and making different compositions in order to fill the set again with as many objects as we could. American International was happy to pay for the dinners, as a matter of fact, because they got much extra work out of us. We got a couple of drinks.
Very well. Brister will show you to a room. I have warned you, sir. Whatever consequences may follow your refusal to leave are upon you alone.
One of the great things about working for American International was that their two partners, Jim Nicholson and Sam Arkoff, were pretty much hands-off during shooting. They would come the first day, have coffee with everybody, wish us well, and then go back to their office and only drop by occasionally. They were making a number of pictures, and they were really establishing American International as the dominant independent company. As a matter of fact, this was the picture that established them. It was their first picture that played alone as a single feature. They had always made two pictures together. We never made second features, B pictures, but we made, say, two science fiction pictures, two horror films, two gangster films, each one in black and white on 10-day schedules, and sent them out as a double bill. Here is an example of the use of foreground composition. I like this shot very much because we've got the candelabra in front, looking at the beginning down the hallway, then dollying and panning and keeping the candelabra in the foreground with an individual cut to it as it shakes. And then, wham! We had great fun with that. Mark said, "You sure that thing is going to miss me?" I said, "Mark, have no worry." I was worried, but I figured the worst would happen. It might hit Mark in the foot, and he had leather boots.
I'm not sure.
Philip, you'd better leave this place. Please leave. It isn't safe for you.
Darling, I'm all right.
I like the cuts to Vincent as well.
I'm not leaving you, Madeline.
Vincent really was in this character all the way. The portrayal of the intelligent, cultured, sensitive villain, as it were, to me was very important. I didn't want him to be a monster. I wanted his intelligence and his sensitivity to be greater than the audience.
For future generations of ushers.
For Madeline's safety.
If you feared him, you feared him for his superior mental qualities, not for his strength for being Arnold Schwarzenegger or something like that.
Do you really think so?
Have you a better explanation? While I was riding here, I noticed a singular lack of vegetation in the area. Is there something wrong with the soil?
The soil? Yes, of course.
Roderick, please.
As you will.
How do things go in Boston, Philip?
Everyone asks for you.
Oh, do they?
They miss you, Madeline. We all miss you.
I think the audience had a divided sense of identification with the characters. On one hand, they could identify with Mark as the handsome young man falling in love with Myrna, becoming involved in a strange romantic situation. Yet at the same time, they might be able to identify with the intelligence, the culture, possibly even thinking of Vincent as a father figure.
Remarkable. And you composed it yourself.
the concept of Vincent as a father figure was in my mind, particularly from my readings and interpretations, or possibly misinterpretations, of Freud. It was also something possibly incestuous.
Very well. Good night, brother.
Good night, my dear.
Good night, Philip.
Good night.
For example, the concept of Myrna kissing Vincent good night, but not kissing Mark good night.
I trust that you will be prepared to leave tomorrow morning.
If you wish. But if I do, I won't be alone. I intend to see that.
American international films traditionally played a great deal in drive-ins, but in actuality, they played, I'd say, 70% in hardtops and about 30%, more or less, in drive-ins. This type of picture was far more effective in a hardtop. Some of the other action films, the gangster films, I did for them, such as Machine Gun Kelly, pictures like that, The Wild Angels, played probably better in drive-ins.
I'm sorry I frightened you. I didn't want to knock for fear your brother would hear.
It's noticeable that when Mark and Myrna kiss or embrace, Vincent, as far as I remember, is never there. I may be fooled, and we may see them embrace in front of Vincent later on, but as I recall, I was making a point of keeping their relationship, although Vincent was, and I really should say Roderick Usher, was aware of their relationship. He was never confronted visually. Except right there. But that comes as a shock, hopefully. So much for my theories. Although it's a twist on my theory.
Roderick.
Is it so easy for you to forget, Madeline?
A life is my own.
Is it?
Yeah.
The picture was shot almost 40 years ago, and I had forgotten that, just as I was talking about their embrace was never in front of Vincent. I realized I got an effect, a shock effect, by having their embrace when they were not aware that Vincent was there, and then the quick pan, hopefully with a shock, to Vincent appearing to see them, illustrated in some way, I would hope, my possibly distorted Freudian theories. As I recall, there was a gasp in the theaters on that shot, as a matter of fact. I don't think there was a scream. It wasn't that much, but there was a sense of shock.
I shall stay with her. In the name of God, sir, will you not understand? Leave my sister be.
Mr. Usher, I mean to take her from this house tonight.
I may have gasped there myself on that shot. Now, that may be out of a sense of shock or the fact that while I was elaborating on my theory was proven wrong in the midst of my sentence. But I can double talk my way out of that by saying I used the shot for shock effect. I haven't seen this film for, I'd say, at least 20 years. And actually, I think it holds up fairly well. It's played fairly consistently still at film festivals and generally gets a big crowd and is well reviewed. The French critics in particular at Cahiers de Cinema and a couple of the other new wave French cinema magazines like this film very much and has established both Vincent and me in a somewhat higher level in Europe as a result of what they read into it, which was to a certain extent what I was trying to put into it and some things that had never actually occurred to me, but it occurred to them. But that may be reasonable. That's part of the job of a critic. On some of the fast pans and shock effects, we undercrank the camera to have the actors and the camera itself move quicker to give a sense of excitement and also a slight sense of unreality. You may notice that there are a lot of little shock effects. None of them were designed to get a big scream from the audience. Those were saved for certain specific moments. But because the picture was, to a certain extent, dialogue heavy and shot in such a confined situation, I was constantly searching for little moments where I could put a touch in to just unsettle the audience. This film, of course, was designed to show Roderick Usher, his sister Madeline, and the house, but through the eyes of Mark. So we're constantly on Mark as he explores the house, intercutting, as in there, just a quick little shock effect, nothing big, but just to unsettle the audience a little bit so that he becomes drawn into it. And the audience, through Mark, becomes drawn into the house. That, of course, was a shock effect that did get a major scream in the audience, both for the shot itself and for the fact that we see Myrna essentially dead. I say essentially dead because things are going to happen.
Walks in her sleep, sir.
And then she comes here?
She's obsessed. By thoughts of death, poor child.
How long has she been doing this?
Ever since her return from Boston, sir. I'll just take her to her room.
No,
no, no. You might awaken her, sir. Better let me. I've done it before.
American International had a policy of making two low-budget horror films, gangster films, whatever, on 10-day schedules in black and white, sending them out together as a double bill. And they wanted me to make two 10-day black and white horror films. And I was getting a little bit tired of it. And I also felt that their policy, because I had a percentage of the profits of the film, their policy was being repeated. And I could see that we weren't making quite as much money as we had earlier. So I convinced them to make one 15-day color film instead of two 10-day black and white films and send it out as an individual picture.
All right, let's see what we have here. Bread, that's good. Milk, a little fruit.
I'll take it to her, sir.
No, I'll do it.
Yes, sir.
Oh, how about some eggs?
Oh, sir, I think perhaps a little gruel. It's the most that she's ever eaten.
There was some slight resistance. Jim Nicholson liked the idea and agreed quickly, and Sam kind of went along with it. He only had one question, and he said, "What is the monster? Where is the monster in the House of Usher?" And I had no real answer to that. We were having lunch, and I said, "The house is the monster." And at that point, Sam agreed, and we made the picture. And I've forgotten where the line was in the picture, but there's some line somewhere where Vincent says something like, "The house lives," or "The house breathes," or something. And Vincent knew that I was working with certain method techniques, and he went along with it. He was a good guy, but I thought sometimes he was trying to put me on. And for that line, he said to me, "What is the motive of this line, 'The house lives'?" And I said, "The motive of that, Vincent, is how we got to make the picture." And he said, "I understand. I know how to say the line."
So long, I'm hardly aware of it anymore. It's just the settling of the house.
That settling can cause this entire structure to collapse. And that doesn't worry you?
Oh, no, sir. If the house dies, I shall die with it. Oh, be careful, sir. It's about to hit you. It can cause a nasty burn.
It's that fissure that causes the entire house to shake.
Yes, sir.
Who is it?
Your breakfast, Miss Usher. Hot gruel and hot gruel. It's so dark in here, I can barely see you. There!
No sunlight.
Part of my theory in relationship to the House of Usher and to the later Poe films is that Edgar Allan Poe was working from the unconscious mind, that we were seeing something unreal, and I wanted to confine it as much as possible to the house itself so that we never had to go out and photograph reality. As I said at the beginning, the only bit of reality we see in this picture is the burned out area in the opening scene, and even that has a slight unreal quality to it because of the fact that it was burned out.
I'm not hungry.
Madeline, I'll have no scrawny woman in my home. Now open your mouth. Come on. Madeline, get ready to leave.
I want to, Philip.
Then you will.
I can't.
Why?
Because very soon I shall be dead.
I forbid you to say that ever again.
It's true, Philip.
It is not true, Madeline.
The contained situation of just these four characters within the house is dictated partially by the story and partially by my feeling that we wanted the contained intensity of the relationships with the people and with the house itself, and that nothing else exists. It's almost as if we are in a separate world.
I
Then let me understand, Madeline. Let me so that I can help you.
Perhaps you'll feel differently after you've seen.
Where are we going?
You'll see.
Careful, Don.
One of the problems in The House of Usher and in the other Poe pictures was that most of Poe's stories were very short, so that we had to take the elements of the story and elaborate on them in order to make a full-length picture. Dick Matheson, the writer, and I worked together on that, and I give Dick great credit for his ability to expand the story, but to stay inside still, I think, the vision and the mind of Poe. The expansion here was primarily in building up the relation between Mark, the visitor, and Madeline.
Here they all are, the Ushers.
It's the lack of air in here.
It's the air itself.
Dick Matheson is one of the best writers I've ever worked with. He's very well known in science fiction and fantasy circles for his own short stories and novels. In addition to the Poe pictures, he wrote, as I recall, The Incredible Shrinking Man and a number of other very successful screenplays. He was so good that we were able to almost shoot his first draft. I've been through the excruciating position of reworking the first draft to the second draft to the third draft with major changes of so many writers, whereas Dick's work was so good in the first draft that we made very few changes and were able to go very quickly into production.
My mother.
This is monstrous. Whose idea was this, your dear brothers?
We had 15 days of shooting and one day of rehearsal. There are Screen Actors Guild rules about paying for rehearsal time, and American International wasn't about to give us a great deal of money for that. So what I would generally do was rehearse one day before shooting, in which we would come in the morning and read through the script twice, and then do a little bit of improvisation around the characters, and then with most of the sets already built, block out loosely the movements within the scenes. It's not what one would like, but it was enough so that all of the actors came in with some preparation. Now you'll notice we have gone to a higher key lighting deliberately in Madeline's bedroom coming out of the crypt below, because the moment of the great suspense slash horror has taken place down below, and I want to change the mood of the picture for a moment for the audience before going back into the darkened situation.
It is not I who force her to live in a cemetery. Do you think that I wish her harm?
I think you still do not understand. And I think it's time that you did. The tarn is very deep. One of the Usher women drowned herself in it. She was never found. I dare say it's deep enough to swallow this house entire.
Here again is an area where I wanted to go outside the house to relieve the constant pressure of the interior scenes, so that when we did photograph leaves or something else, we treated them optically. So, and put in some areas, artificial fog, as in this shot. In other areas, we let a little fog come through and again went to the burned out area to keep the sense of unreality.
Fresh. Swans glided upon its crystal surface. Animals came to its bank, trustingly, to drink. But this was long before my time.
Why do you tell me these things?
And then something crept across the land and blighted. The trees lost their foliage. The flowers languished and died. Shrubs grew brown and shriveled. The grain fields perished. And the lakes and ponds became black and stagnant. And the land withered as before a plague.
Plague?
Yes, Mr. Winthrop. A plague of evil. Anthony Usher, thief.
Here we have some of Bert's paintings, which I really did like very much. I think he conveyed very well the spirit of the picture, in which we are showing a recognized people, but we're showing him through a distorted vision, possibly the distorted vision of the artist who is picking up the distortion within the minds of the people.
Vivian Usher, blackmailer, harlot, murderess. She died in the madhouse. Captain David Usher, smuggler.
I think this was the picture. The red painting was the one that Vincent chose for his house.
I don't see that this has anything to do with Madeline and myself. I don't believe in the sins of the fathers being visited upon the children.
You do not, sir? The house of Usher seems to you then normal?
The house, sir, is neither normal nor abnormal. It is only a house.
You are very wrong, Mr. Winthrop. This house is centuries old. It was brought here from England, and with it every evil rooted in it.
These were not supernatural pictures as such, not ghost pictures. They were, I would say, explorations of a disturbed, or probably a better way to phrase it is, a tormented mind.
Was created by these people. The history of the Ushers is a history of savage degradations. First in England and then in New England. And always.
We're not seeing supernatural effects. We may believe that there is a supernatural element, a ghostly element, but that's part of what we were trying to do, to give an indication to lead the audience in different directions. But in conclusion, we find that we've been really seeing reality through a tormented mind, so that what appears possibly to be supernatural is actually something that is real.
And this is your dreadful secret?
Mr. Winthrop, do you think those coals jumping from the fire onto you?
It is real. Everything that happens is as a result of what is in his mind and what he and his sister did as a result of that.
Those things happen?
Yes.
Oh, no, sir, that's ridiculous. But even if it were true, even if this house were full of evil, Madeline is not. Nor for all of your talk are you.
You cannot take my sister out of this house. If she were to wed and bear children, the Usher evil would spread a new malignant cancer.
You are mad. I will not listen to you.
Yes, you will.
No, I will not. I'll tell you what's evil in this house, sir. You! I will not let your sickened fancies destroy Madeline's life.
We were working on very short schedules, and I know that people have said that I printed the first usable take and moved on to the next shot. But in reality, I generally went 2, 3, 4 takes, something like that. I was moving rapidly, but not quite that rapidly.
We're leaving. Now.
Philip.
Madeline, you have no other choice. If you remain here, this house will destroy you.
Then you know.
I know that your brother has poisoned you with his absurdities. This entire atmosphere of sickness and dissolution is his doing. Oh, Madeline, believe me, there's nothing wrong with you that leaving this house won't cure. Do you love me?
Just about everything in the editing process was planned in pre-production. I'm a strong believer in laying out your shots in advance, particularly on these short schedules. If you have to stop shooting to figure out what you're going to do, you're going to waste a lot of time. So almost every shot, including the cutaways to paintings, the shock cuts, and so forth, were planned before shooting. I did a lot of storyboarding. I had a way of working in which I would draw all my shots on the blank page in the script opposite the printed page, so that I had double pages all the way through the script, so I could look at what I had written and what I had drawn, sometimes making changes in both, but staying moderately close to what had been planned.
No, I will not listen. I've been here long enough. Now, please let me go. I don't care what you say. You can't keep me here. No, Roger. No, I will not listen. Please let me go. There may be no hope for you, but there is for me. I say I will. I must leave, Roger. Please let me go.
Madeline!
I don't care what you say. There's nothing you can say to me, Roderick. I will.
Madeline, open the door.
I should say that when I use the word storyboard, I'm really referring to more of a plan. I have a degree in engineering, and was more likely to draw from above the plan of the set and with lines and angles for the movement of actors. There's another way to do storyboards, which many people, as a matter of fact, it's more common today because directors are working with artists who draw the storyboards for them, which I wasn't doing. I was doing it myself. Working with artists, they will draw the actual shot.
Madeline. No.
Yes, she's dead. I told you she could never leave this house.
What did you do to her?
I didn't touch her.
You killed her!
There is no mark on her. You are the one who killed her.
I like the concept of the off-camera scream or the off-camera sound because it implies something going on around them. There are things happening within this house more than what you see in a close shot in an individual or a close two shot on the screen.
The agony of trying to escape.
There is also the fact that sometimes after shooting, I get the idea I'd like to have a scream here and I lay it in post-production.
One candle left to burn now. Before the darkness comes.
The use of sound effects and of music was not as much pre-planned as the visuals. I would have a general idea where I was going to use music and also an idea of where I was going to use sound, very specifically in some cases for certain shock effects. But generally in the first or second cut, I would start to work out in more detail where I wanted the music and sound.
Because I do not believe that for the Ushers, there is peace hereafter.
Is there no end to your horrors?
No. None whatever. For they are not mine alone. Mere passage from the flesh cannot undo centuries of evil. There can be no peace without penalty.
Yet you wanted her to die.
Wanted?
Yes!
I did not wish her dead.
The picture is primarily designed to be seen through Mark's eyes, but just occasionally we enter Vincent's mind almost, I'm not that familiar with the technical words in music, but almost as a counterpoint so that we see and understand something from Vincent's point of view that Mark does not, such as the closing of the coffin, when Vincent understands that Madeline's fingers moved.
She must take her place below with the rest of the Ushers.
And Mark does not.
One last look.
I cannot bear to look at her.
I'll carry her with you.
Bristol and I can manage. I would rather if you don't mind.
It would appear that Vincent is now becoming more of a villain, and from the audience's point of view, that may be correct. But from his point of view, he is never a villain. He is doing what he must do, knowing what he believes to be the facts. There is no actual villain. Some of the sets, including this staircase, we left up. I hadn't planned to do any more Edgar Allan Poe pictures. I was just doing The Falls of the House of Usher, but we were working at a rental studio, and this set was on a very small sound stage, and they left it up, and we managed to reuse it in several other films. We would dress it and paint it a little bit differently. Thank you. For the time in which I was working, the gothic quality of the films, the unreal vision of Edgar Allan Poe was something new and different. The normal horror films were monster films, and we were trying to do something quite different, to go back to the old gothic qualities of the 18th and 19th century novels. It was new, it was different, and both critically and commercially, the films did very well. I can't claim that in reality they were original, because each time you say, I did something for the first time, somebody else will say, ah, but you've forgotten the German expressionist film of 1919, which of course you've never heard of, and you look at the film and you say, yeah, that guy is really doing just what I was doing.
Some coffee, then?
Yes, a little bit.
Very good, sir. Shall I serve it in the...
No, I'll take it here.
You look tired, sir.
I don't suppose any of us slept much last night.
No, sir.
I cast the three principals, Vincent, Mark, and Myrna, and Vincent suggested Harry Ellerby, who was a very good character actor that was a friend of his and whom he had worked with a number of times for the part of the butler.
Highly overwrought, sir.
And I always liked Harry's work. He worked with me on a couple of other films afterwards.
Don't recriminate yourself, Mr. Winthrop. Miss Madeline's passing was not your fault. She was very weak, poor child. It was the Usher blood. There's been such a history of illness in the family. What with heart ailments, nervous diseases, and the like, sir. Miss Madeline was...
What did you say?
Sir?
You said catalepsies?
Did I, sir?
Was Madeline subject to cataleptic trances?
Oh, no, sir. Not Miss Madeline.
The truth!
No,
was
sir.
Was she?
No, sir.
The use of the word catalepsy there is interesting because it's possible, if not probable, that some members of the audience would not understand it. But I believed, even in what is frankly an inexpensive horror film such as this, not to play down to the audience, to give the audience credit for intelligence, which people have. People are smarter than some members of the media believe.
Leave her in peace, sir. Peace!
When I first suggested that we do The Fall of the House of Usher from Edgar Allan Poe, I've forgotten whether it was Jim or Sam, one of them did say that they didn't think required high school reading would be commercially successful, that people were not going to pay to see something they had been forced to read. But, that was just one of the discussions we had, luckily for all of us, because this was really the film that made American International. Luckily for all of us, those discussions faded.
Where is she?
I don't know, sir.
Tell me!
I don't know, I swear, I don't know. I thought she was here.
You knew she was alive.
I wasn't sure, sir.
You weren't sure! Oh.
Sir!
In today's world, where directors routinely, or at least occasionally, hand in 3 and 4 hour cuts of their films, and then an hour and a half or so has to be taken out of them, we did very little of that. I very, very seldom lost a scene in editing. I believed in paring down the script to what I wanted to shoot, and the most we ever lost would be maybe a few lines of dialogue in some scene where I felt it was playing a little bit long. Pretty much what we shot was what you see.
Where is she?
It's me! Where is she?
Dead.
You lied. You buried her alive.
I did. But she's dead now. I swear it.
You swear it?
Vincent was such a good actor and so experienced, and I, of course, was a young, only moderately experienced director, that I didn't feel that I should try to direct him too much. First, because he really was brilliant, and secondarily, working with method technique, my technique was to discuss the role with the actor in advance of shooting.
Was it necessary to?
You know that it was.
Let me just watch this for a minute.
But it's too late, sir.
No!
Please, sir. Please.
She's alive.
Try to get some rest, sir.
I know she's alive.
Here is one of the fantasy sequences, which I loved shooting, and so did the cast and crew. They became almost a signature of the Poe pictures, in which we would put one or two or three in almost every film. And everybody enjoyed doing them because we could depart from reality. We used special lenses, sometimes distorted lenses, surreal sets, double printing, coming into post-production, desaturating colors, changing colors. They were just fun to do. They were, from a cinema standpoint, from a theoretical standpoint, pure cinema. It was a chance to experiment, to do whatever we wanted, and they were just great to do. Everybody loved doing them. Voices here were not recorded during the shooting. They were recorded in post-production and then mixed with the music so that they all worked together. The fantasy sequences were all shot silent. I really thought of them as exercises in, if you will, cinema technique. I wanted to dispense with sound, dispense with everything other than the pure visuals. As I look at the picture now, after all of these years, I had remembered it as a very heavy dialogue picture because we were confined so much to the interior of the house. But now I'm struck by the amount of silent shooting there was, which I like. I think it was a good idea to break up the dialogue with so much moving camera, moving people, and just playing with sound effects and music so that when the dialogue does come forth, it has greater intensity.
Still here? I suggest you leave, Mr. Winthrop. No? Then perish with us. House crumbles. Perhaps this storm will finish it.
Vincent did not know how to play the lute. However, he faked it very well.
And I intend to see that you hang for it.
Do you? Arrange it quickly, then.
If only I could kill you myself.
Yes, if only you could.
Yes.
Why did you do it?
I told you.
Vincent was a brilliant and very experienced actor.
You'll never understand.
So I did not feel it right to give him intense directions. And as a matter of fact, since I was working with method technique, I tend not to direct that way. What I did was to discuss the role with him in advance, to talk about Roderick Usher's childhood, how he grew up, where he stood at this point in his life, and then get into the motivation, our thoughts, or as Stanislavski would say, the red thread of his performance within this picture.
You are mad.
And really work indirectly that way to bring out the psychological background of the character. Then, on the set, we're just discussing a little bit more the meaning of the scene. I've never believed in giving line readings to actors. I think that's very bad. I prefer to talk about what is going on in the actor's mind, what the actor is feeling. That way you get, it's the great old, almost cliche word, that way you get an organic performance from the actor. The actor is feeling it, hopefully himself.
Turning, scratching at the lid with bloody fingernails, staring, screaming, wild with fury, the strength of madness in her. Can you not hear her voice? She calls my name, Roderick.
This shot got a great scream in the audience, the bloody fingers coming out of the coffin. It's partially the setup. Vincent was very strong in the close-up. And cutting from that to the coffin really worked.
Give me this.
Wait. Don't go down there. Let her die.
All of this was planned. Sometimes I varied from the plan a little bit, and sometimes I changed a little bit in the editing. But pretty much I had these things figured out. You had to. This is actually, as I look at it, it's a surprisingly complex picture for a 15-day schedule, because today, now that I'm primarily producing, I don't expect much from our directors on the 15-day pictures. They're much simpler pictures than this. For this amount of complexity, I will generally give a director 4 or 5 weeks. Maybe I'm just getting easier in my old age. Or maybe I could work harder and faster when I was young. This was the first of my, I've forgotten, 5 or 6 or maybe 7 Edgar Allan Poe pictures. I didn't really plan to make a series. I simply wanted to make The Fall of the House of Usher. And I wanted to stay as close and as true to Poe's vision as I possibly could. As we got deeper into the series, we started varying a little bit because I felt we were in danger of repeating ourselves. And starting, I think, with The Raven, we started bringing some humor into them, which I liked very much, but we were really at that point beginning to vary from Poe's original concept. And at that point, I stopped. They were all successful, and American International wanted me to continue. But I said, I've really done what I can do on this subject, and it's time to move on. So I went from the Poe pictures to contemporary reality. The Wild Angels, The Trip, films such as that that were shot in the streets never were shot in a studio. Actually, the destruction of the house, which is going to be coming shortly, was something I looked forward to, and so did the crew. We knew we were going to have a great time. The crew and I got along very well. We were all good friends. We were all trying the best we could with limited means to do the best job we could. And we knew we were going to have a great time when the fire started. The rat there was just something I decided to put in. No particular reason to have a rat on the stairs, other than I thought it might get a little bit of a squirm or squeal from the audience, and indeed it did. I think you have to keep these little things going in between the big plotted shock effects. Again, in sequences like this, where I'm showing the paintings, I try to bury it as much as I can. I use some slow pans, some whip pans, some medium shots, some close shots. It was a real problem. On the other hand, they were interesting solutions to continually show the paintings and not to have the shots repeat themselves. Also, the idea here in following the drops of blood on the floor was a way to show his movement and then the bloody door handle there. It's just a way to do something a little bit differently. At this point, we start to bring back in some of the voices, some of the music from the fantasy sequences. We're starting almost to repeat his fantasy and give the suggestion that maybe what was his fantasy before is now starting to become reality. It's various ways to build the level of suspense. And there, we got a real scream then. The close-ups, the cutting, and of course the first entrance of Madeline coming in sharply from the side of the screen. I don't know if I said screen or scream, but essentially it's the same thing. That type of shot is always helped by a sharp, hard sound effect and by a crescendo in the music. At this point, we really had the audience going. As I say, I haven't seen the picture for a long time, but it's bringing back memories of how well it really played.
Madeline.
Myrna was a method actress who had studied with Sandy Meisner, and she really worked herself into a frenzy to do these scenes. I thought she was great. And here is where we really started to have fun. The starting of this fire. Everybody loved it. We had everything working here. We had the fire, we had the smoke, we had the special effects, the match shot there, falling dust. The music is building.
There was no other way. No other way.
In that shot there, the shot of the burning rafters, since we were shooting everything in the studio, everything else was shot in the studio, but that was an old barn that we found that somebody was going to destroy and we paid him to burn. So that shot there of the firing of the falling rafters, a couple of those shots were from the barn, but everything else was shot on the set. And as I say, we had great fun. We had a fire marshal there. And I had somebody sort of keeping him happy and talking to him because we were really going a little bit beyond what we should have done. This again was the burning barn, those long shots, but everything else was the burning on the set. As a matter of fact, when I did The Mask of the Red Death in England and I had a burning sequence there, the head of the studio said to me, we've heard what you were doing in Hollywood, and you can't do that here. He said, we heard you almost burn down the studio. And I said, I didn't do that. It's possible that we singed the roof of the soundstage a little bit, but we didn't burn down a studio. But I remember that I did not get as good a fire effect in Mask of the Red Death because the English were very, very careful about what they would let me do. Actually, we reused some of these fire shots in other films. It got to the point where I'd used fire in so many films for the climax that when I did The Terror with Boris Karloff, I deliberately wrote into the script that they were next to some sort of a dam, and the dam had burst, and we had the house flooded. I figured that was the opposite of fire. One of the signature effects of these films, as it were, was that at the end, we showed the actors again in close-up at the end of the film, and followed by putting most of our credits in larger sizes than normal. That way we got into the picture faster at the beginning without having the audience sit through a lot of credits. And at the end, we were able to give the people who were all friends of mine and all worked very well, we were able to give them more prominent end credits. This is Roger Corman. I hope you liked The House of Usher. I liked making it, and I actually had a good time here talking about it once more. It was a successful film when it came out, and it did lead to the other Poe films, of which I hope you will have a chance to see.